I know you're sort of jumping the gun, but a lot of people are very apathetic because there's a belief that politicians are only nice during elections, you know, so they come out, sometimes they share things. I've seen bags of rice, handbags, you know, all of that, recharge cards. And you, whatever questions you ask, they're very willing to answer. Mm-hmm. Every interview, they're available. You know, mm-hmm. town hall meetings, they're there. But as mm-hmm. soon as they get in, it's sort of, okay, we're back in our hole or in our bubble until the mm-hmm. next cycle comes again. So talking about these questions that we need to ask, mm-hmm. how do we keep the questions going when sometimes it feels like these politicians are not accessible?
You mean not accessible during the elections or after?
After the elections, yeah, so when they get into office.
That's why we have to pay extra attention to those questions while they are campaigning. And the reason, the fact that they are more accessible during the elections is enough for us to ask the important questions. I've been reading, you know, the policy documents of some candidates, and they're saying, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do this. But they're not answering the how. We know that you're going to do this, you're going to give us roads, but tell us how. And those are the kind of questions that we should focus on. When you have an idea of the how, do they plan to increase the budget? Do they plan to increase taxation? All those little things. When you have an idea of the how, it's to give you a sense of direction to what they are, you know, what they stand for or their beliefs and all these kind of things. Those are the kind of questions we need to ask them now that we have the chance. It's what is going to, you know, give you the build up to knowing that, all right, I think this guy is going to perform. The I will do this is easy. It is the how will you do it? How will you implement it? What will you do that we need to start asking now? Because I am 100% certain that when they get in, you will not see them again.
Yeah. Do you agree?
Yeah, I agree. And to add to what she's saying, I'm very critical when it comes to manifestos of politicians. Mm-hmm. I try and listen deeper. If a politician comes out to say, I'm going to create 4 million jobs, mm-hmm. I'm always critical about it because currently you can see some states cannot even pay salaries with the current size and wage structure we have and current labor structure. So how are you going to create more jobs? But if you talk as a politician about creating an enabling business environment for SMEs, because SMEs are the biggest drivers of the economy. If you have more SMEs, people are going to be engaged and employed. Then I'll listen to you and I'll know that, okay, this guy is sincere. This guy knows what he's doing. It's the same thing when you talk about electricity. When I come, I'm going to make 40,000 megawatts and do all that. How are you going to do it? You have to be critical. You have to know that, okay, this person has actually done a lot of research. And when he has done a lot of research, I'm sure that, okay, this person has a team. He knows what he's working on. Because basically, it's always the slogans. They always come with the same things. They say the same things. These things sound cliche. They sound familiar in our environment. We need to be sure that what this guy is saying, I'm very sure about it. What this guy is saying, he has worked on it. And from there, it's easier to implement.
Yeah. One thing I want to ask now, because we're talking about the details now and the how. Speaking of details, what sorts of questions should young people be asking? Because as much as we'll be asking questions, what matters to you may not matter to the manufacturer in Newi, mm-hmm. because your issues are different, or the pensioner in Ibadan. Most young people have sort of similar issues. So as a young person, what sort of questions or what should we be looking out for in a candidate?
So I'll say because we're young people and I think we should ask them, we should be focused on a candidate that has more solid long-term plans because this is our future on the line. So when I say long-term plans, in terms of building strong institutions, that's where our questions should be tilted to. So it's kind of like if you say basic things like how will you build the roads and they give you some flimsy excuse and then there's nothing to show that there's going to be strong infrastructure in the future, then how are we going to, you know, how are we going to know that this continuity will be present?
So let's pay for them.
So let's be specific in terms of continuity, in terms of long-term plans, in terms of, okay, you're going to build infrastructure, but what exactly are you going to put in place so that after you go, that this is going to be here. We've had precedents like, what's the president of Venezuela, Hugo Chavez or something. Everybody thought he was fantastic until he left office, because his whatever he built there could not outlive him. There was nothing for the young people then to go, you know, to go further. We'll never be able to access someone like Kagame now until he actually leaves office, because everything, we're seeing some great things now, but will those things outlive him? Those are the kind of little things that we should focus on. Healthcare. Healthcare can be great during your tenure, but have you built an institution that will ensure that this keeps running? Have you, like, those are the little things that we should, so let's be more focused on things that will actually be permanent, things that will last, not after 4 years or 8 years, then someone else will come and, you know, disrupt the institution and start again.
So are jobs the biggest issue for young people, you think?
Yes, jobs are actually the biggest issue, and it gets more competitive as the year goes by. If you look at the statistics, in 2030, 2050, we're going to be the third largest population in the world. So is the government ready for that? That's what we have to ask ourselves.
I'm not ready for that.
ourselves that question. So when we ask ourselves that question, jobs are very important. It's how they make these jobs, how they create these jobs. They're not going to open an agency and say they are recruiting. No. How are they going to make an enabling business environment? That is the key thing. So we youth are always interested in that, things that will make our life better. So we know that, okay, in the long run, we know that things are going to get better and better. And however, without looking at what is going on currently, we look at debt profile, we look at the reserves, we look at, okay, are these people saving for our future? Are they diversifying this oil sector? Are they diversifying the economy? So that we know that if oil is at $20, $10, $30, looking at the whole supply and demand, we know that we are still going to have a future. We are not dependent on oil. So we look at these things that are very, very critical. And when we find the answer to that, we are good to go.
All right. We're going to take a break now. When we come back, we'll find out how realistic a lot of the expectations of our first-time voters are considering the pool of candidates we have now. Please stay with us. Welcome back. We're concluding our conversation with our first-time voters. And before the break, I said I was going to ask, you know, looking realistically now, the people we have, because all the forms have been submitted to INEC. We know our candidates. And I want to maybe keep it to our presidency now, because we don't know what local governments or states you're going to be voting in. Looking at the pool of candidates we have with our presidential candidates, I know a lot of the manifestos are out now, but we kind of have a feel of some of them, what they're talking about. Are you hopeful?
Hopeful in terms of
sort of your expectations from a candidate.
So, you know, interestingly, I'm particularly excited about this election because we've seen a change from previous years. Now, more of the candidates are, you know, speaking out in terms of there are people having world press conferences. One of the candidates is having hers tomorrow. More people are talking about what they're doing. We've seen one of them released their policy documents, another one is preparing on it. So it seems like there's a more conscious effort to communicate with the voters this time. And so that is the part that is making me a bit hopeful. Yeah. Because before now, you could barely see, you know, them communicating, saying what they want to do, granting as much. I don't think, I mean, since I've started observing, I don't think we've had more interviews than this particular election.
And it's not even really started.
Do you get what I mean? And then we're having more third, fourth candidates now. So it seems like, you know, the conversation is shifting. People are more politically aware. People have started asking the right questions. Candidates are doing more of the talking. So am I hopeful? Yes, in that regard, I am hopeful because I know that the next election, even after 2019, would be, you know, would be even be better in terms of communications.
Building,
yes, so I am happy.
Agree?
Well, I agree with what she said. I'm sure as years goes by, our democracy is getting stronger. We have an emerging democracy we have to protect. We have to protect this democracy. And we've seen in antecedents, we've looked at antecedents or previous elections, incumbent governors, incumbent presidents are being ousted the first term. Those were impossible before. Those aren't possible in other countries. Citizens who are subject to dictatorship, citizens of other countries, like certain countries in Africa, they are subject to things like you have establishments that don't want to leave the offices. So, but here is a different thing. It's a different ball game. People are actually fair. They are actually scared. These politicians are scared of our votes. They know that if they slip up, if they are being complacent, they will be out anytime soon. So it actually is improving their competence. They will be like, they know that it's not the order of the day. They know it's not like before. So, looking at all these candidates, ideally, the way people vote, the way most people are guilty of voting is they look at the two big candidates and they see which one is the lesser evil, which one is the greatest good, because they don't believe the other guys have a realistic chance of winning. And the funny thing is, there are so many millions of people in that category. They don't believe this guy will win. Option C will win, option D will win. You'd be like, okay, so let's not waste our votes at that line. Let's keep our votes between A and B. But when, like I said, politics is a game of numbers. When A in Abuja, A in Lagos, C in Kwara, when we keep doing these things, we all take away our votes from someone that could have been better.
Oh, you really believed in.
Someone you really believed in, because we're all thinking alike. We need to stand firm and believe that these guys can win. And we're looking at the France example. Macron was away from the establishment. So we need to believe that it can happen in Nigeria. Yes, it might not happen in 2019 because these other politicians don't have a structure and our voting population is not, we're not well informed and educated as the French. Let's be honest with that. Because the irony of it is, the percentage of people that decide our future in this country is probably 1/8. If you look at the 2015 election, and this 1/8 of the people are not educated, they are not literate as the French. Yeah. So we need to be sure that
some more voters
can come and, okay, we get better. And we believe that another party or another politician can win. But we just have to believe. It's just about belief.
Thank you very much, Akpeoluwa. Thank you very much, Aisha. Good luck with your with your votes.
Thank you.
And like they've said, if you're a young person out there, stand firm, hold on to your vote, and please make sure you do go out and vote, because it is a very crucial time in our nation's history, and you, only you, can decide that. Like I always say, you can follow the conversation on Twitter. YNigerTV is the handle. The hashtag to follow is Robin Minds. You can also visit our website, YNiger.tv. Thanks for joining us. I'll see you next Sunday.